In this video, the benefits and applications of material extrusion are explained.
When we look at the pros and cons of material extrusion, one thing that springs out right away is the wide range of standard plastics that can be used. Can be used with and without reinforcement, which is also very important. And the reinforcement can be short, long, and continuous fibers and other additives that help with shrinkage reduction and other things. We can produce fully functional parts, and the parts can be post-processed. Even so, they have the stair-step structure. We have the capability, because we know these materials really well, to do mechanical and chemical post-processing. And we can produce the biggest parts that you can think of, because the machines we have are 1 cubic meter or larger. And this is an area that's called big area additive manufacturing, or BAM. Disadvantages of the process are definitely the anisotropy that we have. It's most dominant in the C direction, so between layers. We have a step structure on the surface, which requires post-processing. I said it's good that we can do it, but we also have to do it. When you look at some of the parts, and I move my finger across the surface, you could even hear it, the stair-step structure, because I'm going along this, and it scratches. Fine details cannot be realized. I have an example here of a little face mask that we printed during a student expo, and it has details on top of it. But if those were any deeper, it would actually get really hard to produce them. Support structure is needed. Good thing is it can be soluble or break away. And as you put bead next to bead, we get small voids in the parts, which is a problem for stress in a crack initiation and stress propagation. Some of the downfalls or shortcomings of material extrusion. Applications that we have, I want to distinguish between applications without reinforcement, that's the original process as it came out end of the 80s, and with reinforcement, which are definitely some of the newer processes. I brought a couple of examples here, mostly just gimmicks. I just pointed out this mask. We did a cookie cutter during one of my classes at UW-Madison. And then I have more functional parts. So this is a bearing. And that was produced with soluble support on a Stratasys machine. So after you remove and wash off the soluble support, the little balls inside of the bearing are loose and can be moved right away. Then this is a salt and pepper dispenser. It has a thread, so that's as fine as the detail goes. And I can really nicely screw that on, and it fits with that line, so that works really well. And here's another example of a functional part. That's actually a clip to close a bag of potato chips. Whoever's not finishing their bags of potato chips, I don't know. But here you see that we can print with two different colors. We don't have to use it for support structure and build material. If we come up with a design that doesn't require support, we can use the two nozzles for actually two different materials. So let's look at some of the applications that other people have done. Without reinforcement, you see a big variety of images here on the right. You can produce functional prototypes, support parts, fixtures and jigs, for example, that you can see here, the guy holding with the two hands, to pick up a part and then position it always in the correct location. Small series parts or one-of-a-kind non-structural parts, for example, this mirror gimmick. You can use it to make molds for sheet metal forming, thermoforming plastics, and even fiber-reinforced plastics. There has been a development to use reinforcement in it, but if you don't need it, why put it in? You can also use it as soluble cores. If you print with the soluble material, you can produce hollow structures, for example, in a composite part. And you can use it for casting. For sand casting, that means you would print with that process and create the positive of the part that you want to get. You embed it in sand, and you would then take the part out and have the negative sand mold of that part, or you could print that positive in a PLA, for example, and put that in the sand mold and not take it out. And then as the liquid metal is being poured in, it just melts and vaporizes more or less the PLA, and that creates the cavity. So those are two options for casting. And then we have the whole group of processes that use reinforcement. And I have a couple of images here just as examples. There's plenty more. Can also be used for functional prototypes, also for support parts, fixtures and jigs, and small series parts or one-of-a-kind structural parts. And here I wanted to point out prosthetics. That's a bigger area. Obviously, it's small in the quantities, but it's really useful to think of 3D printing and additive manufacturing in that area. And then we can have molds and tooling. For example, at the very top right, you see an autoclavable mold that is made with fiber reinforcement for a fiber reinforcement composite cure in the autoclave, done by Oak Ridge National Lab down in Tennessee.